Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Lauren Poland. I'm with the Habitat Conservation Planning Branch of California Department of Fish and Wildlife, and I'm here to introduce our presenter today. So we have another lecture as a part of our conservation lecture series, and you can view upcoming conservation lectures and register for them on the website listed right here, and you can also view past videos and see the presentation materials from the past ones as well. So we have a few ones coming up after this. We have development of multi-threaded wetland channels and the implications for salmonids and ecosystem rehabilitation on November 19th, and bay checkerspot butterfly in the Santa Clara Valley Habitat Conservation Plan on December 2nd. And we should have a few more of those popping up pretty soon. All right, so today we're pleased to have Dr. Michael Pollock presenting a lecture on process-based stream restoration. Dr. Pollock was born, raised, and educated in Northern California and is a proud product of that environment. He graduated with a degree in biochemistry from Humboldt State University and went on to take a job doing basic research at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center in Seattle, where he studied the effects of genetic mutations on neural ion channel function. From there, he took the obvious next career step and went to the University of Washington to earn his doctorate in ecosystems analysis from the College of Forest Resources. After several years of interesting career experiences and public service, he accepted a research position with NOAA's Northwest Fishery Science Center Watershed Program, where he is currently employed. At the Science Center, Dr. Pollock's research has focused on understanding the physical and biological processes that shape and maintain fluvial ecosystems. Dr. Pollock also analyzes the potential effects of proposed and existing policies on the integrity of fluvial ecosystems. He is currently shifting attention towards the development of comprehensive science-based regulatory frameworks to help facilitate the construction of large-scale process-based restoration projects that will produce high levels of ecosystem goods and services, inclusive of fishery production and groundwater recharge. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Michael Pollock.
Great. Hey, thank you everyone for making it today and all those out on the web. Giving this talk, it's a great opportunity. I had a number of opportunities to work on developing process-based restoration projects in the state of California, elsewhere as well, up and down the coast in Washington and in Oregon. So it's been an interesting process in and of itself, learning how to do these and understanding the science behind them, and then also understanding the regulatory framework within which we operate and how we can move forward adjusting and interpreting the regulatory framework so that we can engage in process-based restoration projects. So today, really want to talk about dams and this idea of using dams to restore fluvial ecosystems or streams. And the short answer of why would we want to use dams, and we'll talk about what we mean by that, the types of dams and such, is to create something called a stage zero channel. And so a couple of things right off the bat is really to talk about the definitions of what we mean by ecologically functional dams and what we mean by stage zero channels or fluvial systems. And when I put this together, I guess I should have known in retrospect, but I was sort of tongue-in-cheek saying, well, yes, let's put 10,000 more dams out on the landscape. And I'm thinking about dams in the context of, say, beaver dams or wood jams or things that are more in the sense of obstructing flow or obstructing the movement of sediment or slowing it down. And so, anyway, I heard from a number of people that really wondered what I was thinking. And they're like, God, are you nuts? Don't you work for a fisheries organization? But that speaks to the need to have clarity in a multidisciplinary avenue such as stream restoration to really have an understanding of what we mean by our terms and what these terms actually mean so that we're all at least have a common language that we can work from. So I'll talk about the stage zero channel and what that means, and that's a new term that I think not everyone is familiar with. And we'll talk about its attributes, occurrence in the landscape, its ecological importance, and then really get into some of the process-based principles for restoring these highly functional channels and the role of ecologically functional dams. And then we'll talk about examples at multiple scales and kind of look at how these processes operate at different spatial scales and how we might think about restoration at different scales, some of which are ongoing right now. So first, ecologically functional dams, really natural semi-permeable in-stream structures for their human analogs, which slow transport rates of sediment and water to help create, restore or maintain stage zero channels. Generally consist of mud or natural materials such as wood and other organic matter, live vegetation, rocks, and mud. Examples include wood jams, beaver dams, rock slides, debris jams, standing live trees, and shrubs, and emergent vegetation. So again, things that you might not necessarily think of as a dam in the conventional sense of the word, but from a biological or a process-based perspective, all of these are obstructing flow and sediment transport. So what is a stage zero channel? Well, we'll give you a lot of verbiage and then some examples of it, but the sort of general terminology is a dynamically metastable network of anabranching channels with vegetated islands which create physically and biologically complex habitats that provide high levels of ecological goods and services. And they occur across a wide range of stream sizes, so very scalar. Typical characteristics include well-connected floodplains with elevated water tables, multi-threaded channels, spatially variable hydrologic regimes, and structurally complex aquatic and riparian habitat. There's a number of aspects to them. We can provide a little bit more detail. The hydrologic regime, floods diffused over full width of the floodplain, so flood peaks are maximally attenuated. Flood pulses diffused and subdued, high water tables, and close connection between stream flow and groundwater ensures reliable base flows and continuous hyperreus flow and smaller anabranches may be ephemeral. So a complex hydrologic system. Hydraulics and substrate, multiple channels provide maximum in-channel hydraulic diversity through partition of discharge between branches that widen range of in-channel depth velocity combinations. Very important. Anabranching create multiple flow water margins and channels. So again, that variation in velocity. Wide range of substrate sizes, grain sizes arranged into numerous well-sorted bed patches. So really, I hope you're getting a sense of a very complex and heterogeneous environment. Dimensions and morphology, multiple anabranches, islands, and side channels, morphological features abound in channel and on the extensive and fully connected floodplain, providing a high capacity to store sediment and wood and support diverse wetlands and aquatic habitats. Bank heights are low with stability enhanced by riparian margins, but some unvegetated banks are generally generated by localized erosion. Network and floodplain are highly resilient to disturbance buffering the system. Then finally, vegetation. Frequent small channel adjustments and high reliable water table create ubiquitous settings for proliferation and succession of aquatic, emergent, riparian, and floodplain plants. Wet woodlands on islands and floodplains supply and retain wood, and widespread vegetation proximal to channels produces abundant leaf litter. When present, beaver use vegetation to build dams and lodges. Biogenic obstructions such as large wood, beaver dams, and live vegetation help to create and retain an anabranching channel pattern. So that's the verbiage, and there's much more, but you can read about some of that in some of the references that are cited, Cluer and Thorne being preeminent, and then a paper we put out in 2014. We're going to look at some examples of it, and I think that will help a lot more than what we just went through. But the question of where do stage zero channels occur, well, there's a lot of places, but the predominant areas are in low gradient stretches where there's a wide valley. And so starting from the top, you've got a sediment supply zone, so some of what we call mountain meadows, areas such as that where there's a little bit of a valley for a stream to move around. Alluvial fans, that's something we don't talk about a lot in this context, but again, you've got this multi-threaded system that's very complex, not as biologically important. Transfer zones, they tend to be transferring sediment and water through a system rather than depositing as much, but you can still have some of them occur there. And then really the depositional zones in the lower parts of the valleys, that's really where you see this full fruition of these stage zero systems, and that's where there's really they have the highest potential in terms of ecological value to exist. So again, thinking of a picture is worth a thousand words or more, here's an example of one. This is from the Salmon River, Idaho, and note the numerous features and some of what we just talked about. There's a lot of off-channel habitat. There's a lot of different flow velocities. It's well vegetated. Obviously, the water table is right near the surface. These are some of the things that you really are characteristic. Here's one of the Lemhi River in Idaho, and again, you can see multiple channels in there. Hard to tell exactly how high the water table is, but the fact that it's green and you're in Idaho tells you that the water table's got to be somewhat near the surface there. And you've got a lot of oxbows, abandoned channels, and just really a lot of hydraulic and hydrologic complexity there. Here's another example from the Peel River, and notice that there's a lot of channels, a lot of wetlands, really a complex system. Here's one from the Wenaha River tributary. And this is a much smaller system, and this is really to point out that these really occur from very large rivers down to smaller ones as long as there's room. And note the off-channel habitat and the sinuosity and really a complex system relative to some of the more common types you see typically. So stage zero channel, where does this come from? Well, it really, I think I can use the, this. So this really comes from the what's called a stream evolution model, and there's been a number of those evolution models, but there's really this idea of, if you think about plant succession, it's similar to that, but for a geomorphological or a hydrogeomorphological or really more properly a biohydrogeomorphological condition in a stream, and that they go through a successional process, much in the way of a plant community might. But what triggers it, though, is land use changes or changes in climate. And so starting at the top here, stage zero, it's kind of the initial condition of a high-value wetland or stream system. And there's a number of characteristics that we just went through. What happens typically due to land use, but also due to climate change, is these systems in size. And so they cut down, and that's stage one. They begin to go from this multi-threaded condition to a single-thread channel, and they become somewhat simplified, but they still have a high value. And then from there, they start degrading. There's increased degradation. They start widening. You can see it widening a little bit out here. The widening really moves through this process. So it cuts down. They tend to cut down, widen, and then through this slow process over there on the left, they begin to deposit sediment again, and they start to build themselves up. And over time, they will retain and come back to either stage eight or back to stage zero potentially eventually. So it's this long process of stream evolution that plays out over centuries to millennia. We'll talk about some of the time frames in a bit. But the fact is that we have these systems. All of our streams are at some level going through one of these. They're either in an intact system, as some of the ones we saw, or they're in this various degradative phase where they have less ecological value. So we, Brian Cluer, who's a co-author on this, he had worked on really looking at each of these stages of evolution in a channel system and looking at some of the benefits to each of them. And so you don't really have to look at this chart other than to show that the various attributes were ecosystem benefits were analyzed for each of the different types of stages, and then given some sort of a score for in terms of how much importance they provided for that particular benefit. So then you take that and you can come up with a benefits matrix or really a benefit cycle, and this is just a really kind of broad brush overview, but it shows the size of the circles there show you the relative amount or benefit that each of these stages has. And what going through that process, what you see is stage zero, stage one, tend to have high benefits, and then as you go through this degradative process, you tend to get fewer and fewer benefits until you start on the, again on the left, you start to see those processes and benefits kicking in again. So this is just real quick here. I'll just give you all of this. So this shows you that from the x-axis, you're looking at hydrogeomorphic attributes, and then on the y-axis, habitat and ecosystem benefits. And what you can see is this kind of hysteresis curve, where you've got a stage zero channel up in the right. Here, let's see if we go. Here we go. Oops. Let's go back. Up here, you've got something, a stage zero. It shows high habitat and ecosystem benefits. Really, you're close to 100%, and a lot of positive hydrogeomorphic attributes. Then as you go through this degradation process following this line down, you drop down further and further until you really don't have very much in the way of benefits. And then over time, and with potentially restoration, you work your way back up. And so you're going through this sort of aggradation, degradation, but also good habitat, bad habitat cycle. Unfortunately, for a lot of our stream systems, because of our land use history, an awful lot of them are down here. They're fives, twos, fours. They're really not in very good shape. And that's sort of the context within which we come in to restore these systems. We're looking at them, or we're looking at how they behave. And fundamentally, in a lot of cases, we're looking at very degraded systems. And so we really need to be careful about how we view what a stream should function, how it should be behaving in the context of what its historical trajectory has been. Probably the most sort of famous example is the extirpation of beaver, where we've got a lot of stream systems that historically had huge amounts of beaver. I mean, millions and millions, tens of millions of beaver across North America. Those have been largely extirpated. Well, we didn't start, and that happened by the 1850s, most of them were gone. They'd been trapped out, and the fur economy collapsed. And then after that, stream ecology at that time wasn't even a discipline. And so stream ecology started really getting in the 20th century, getting going. And by that time, not just beaver, but one of many things that had changed. So we started looking and analyzing and understanding how these systems work without the presence of one of the major geomorphic drivers of how these systems behave. So it's just one example of how we've really altered these systems, and we're not really looking at what fundamentally healthy systems look like in a lot of cases. This is just a graph. It's a really simplified version. This is from our 2014 paper, really just simplifying that aggregation channel evolution model or stream evolution model, and really just to point out that there's really four basic phases. There's a dynamic equilibrium up there on the top. It goes to an incising phase, a widening phase, and then a grading phase. And at each of these tend to take long time periods, almost a logarithmic scale. But incision can occur over a period of years. Widening can occur over years to decades. And then this aggradational process, the slow buildup of your alluvium and really getting some of these more complex systems, that can take centuries to even millennia. And then dynamic equilibrium, where you've got these functional systems, that can persist sort of indefinitely. And the geologic record suggests that in many cases it's persisted for a very long time. So just throw in this little take-home message if you don't get anything else, and we'll talk about some of these, but considerably more. But degraded streams have limited ecological function, and most of our streams are degraded. And here's an example from Putah Creek in California. And then two points that we'll talk about is really that the scale of restoration of streams needs to be commensurate with the scale of the actions that caused the degradation. And so a lot of the restoration that we're doing and really doesn't address the root causes or the processes that have been altered. So that's something that needs to be addressed. And then also that meaningful restoration needs to occur on a time frame relative to recovery time frames for target species, such as salmon, so as to avoid extinction. And if you go back to, we can just actually look at that one. I mean, you could look at this, at Putah Creek, right? You say, all right, well, you know, let's let it restore on its own. Let's do a little bit of work, and your model show that it's going to recover over time. That's true, and we had this question before. Why don't we just leave things alone and let them recover on their own? The problem is that the rate at which they recover isn't really commensurate with some of our management goals, which ostensibly is to prevent the extinction of a number of species. So that's just something to bear in mind, because this question of whether we manage a stream or an ecosystem passively or manage it actively comes up. And from my agency's perspective, our job is to assist in the recovery of ESA-listed species, primarily salmon. And so we really have specific targets that we've got to get these populations back into shape, and we've got to get the habitat back into shape so the populations can recover. So we don't have time to wait on these things, and that's what why we're focused on restoration and really high-value restoration. So I want to talk about the principles for building stage zero systems. And this is a really, this is Lane's balance for those of you with a geomorphological background. And it's really a simple illustration that if you got anything out of this whole talk, you know, understanding how the system works, understanding this diagram would really help you understand stream systems and what we're talking about here. And what this balance shows, this is kind of the conventional way about thinking about streams, is that a system is in equilibrium, and here's a little arrow showing equilibrium between incision and aggradation. And so when you've got a balance of sediment inputs and discharge, you can use the equation down here, down below. You've got a balance, and when it's in the sense of equilibrium, you either have incision or aggradation. Then if you look at this scale, you can slide it. If you start getting coarser material in terms of sediment, you're going to tip the balance. Well, which way is it going to go? It's going to go towards aggradation. If your sediment supply starts fining out, it goes the other way, incision. Likewise, for stream slope, if your stream slope goes up, that will tend to alter it and give you more stream power, and you've got the potential for incision. And likewise, when you flatten it out, deposition occurs. So that's all well and good. But the issue with a lot of our streams is that they're over here. This balance has already been tipped, and so we've got incision that's occurred, and we've got the lowering of water tables, which is, in particular for California, a really critical problem right now, that we've lost a lot of our capacity to store water and to get groundwater recharge. So we started looking at, well, how do you play with this balance, and how do you get these alluvial systems back? And what the real simple answer is you increase flow resistance, hence the argument for dams. And by increasing flow resistance, you trap sediment and you cause aggradation to occur and you build your channel back up. And so by putting in obstructions to flow, I mean, if you think about anybody that has a term other than dams that they'd like to put out at the end of this, I'd be happy to hear it. But flow obstructions, things that slow down the movement of water and sediment, semi-permeable structures, putting those in really can rapidly accelerate your restorative process. We have been looking at biogenic obstructions because biology is part of the system, and historically stream restoration has really just looked at the physical processes, the balance between water. So we threw in, well, what happens if you put in the biology or biogenic obstructions into the process? And some of those include, again, as we mentioned earlier, beaver dams, wood, and vegetation, live vegetation, those being the primary things. So, and what we get is, as we'll see, is aggradation and a lot of these functions returning to streams. This is just another way to look at it if that diagram doesn't work for you. As we can look at factors controlling stage zero or really any channel formation. So here's a channel. The key things are channel slope, discharge, sediment supply, sediment size, valley confinement. We didn't actually cover that. That has a big effect. Bank material. Again, these are the physical factors controlling channel formation. And then the biogenic factors are biology, vegetation, beaver in particular, and then herbivores, both as how they affect the vegetation from a wood input and vegetation composition in terms of wood input, but also in terms of food supplies for beaver. And then if you're really looking at this thing holistically and looking at all the parts, you've got to look at predators because they control both the abundance of beaver and some of the herbivores. So all of these systems, all of the physical processes and biological processes have a control on the formation of our stream channels, which isn't something that we always think about. So I'll jump to beaver dams, which is, for those of you that know, something we've looked at for some time in terms of using them for ecosystem recovery. And what we've got, this is just from our bioscience paper, is this goes through a step of how, sort of steps by in a cartoon fashion, how they can recover these incised channels. So here on A, you've got an incised system. You've got beaver coming in. They're trying to build a dam, but the stream power is really high. And so what typically happens in the first step of this is that they blow out and the stream widens, not unlike what we saw in the model. But then they come back and they trap sediment again. There's vegetation that gets accumulates and helps to also trap the vegetation. And so that persists as a stream with ponds for a while. Then it might blow out again over in D, but it's built up. And so you're no longer, say, on bedrock. You've got more alluvium. And you're getting a little bit of complexity there. And then you go to E and you go through this process again. And so you're going through this dynamic process of storing water and accumulating sediment, having it blow out and transitioning again from a ponded environment to a stream environment. And all along the way, as you're doing this, you're increasing complexity. And so in F here, you've got a system that's a graded back. It's got ponds. It's got multi-threaded channels. It's got a lot of vegetation. It's got the groundwater system has elevated again. And so we've raised it from down low in this example in A to high here. So the nice thing about using something like this is that we're able to accelerate some of these processes of recovery that might take centuries to even longer. And we're seeing some really impressive results in the order of a few years and potentially decades. So this is just an example of a natural beaver dam showing some of the things that they provide, but what they look like. And then we did some experimentation with beaver dam analogs. So we said, well, if these things can be used effectively in terms of stream restoration, can we build them so we have an opportunity not to rely on a rodent, but to actually put them where we want to put them and control where they go, how high they go, and really demonstrate that we can mimic the effects of these dams. And so this is just an example up here. Down below to your left is an example where we put one in right where my mouse is. That was a pond initially upstream, and it filled in with gravel, and then it created this sinuous complex system. So we took a kind of linear system, put a dam in it, and created this. And this is just some other examples. This is one from California, and then this is one from Oregon. And then this is just an overhead of a one in Oregon, another place on Bridge Creek, and this is just gives you sort of the scale of we putting one in here. There's one there. There's another one there you can't really see, and then one around down here. So this is an overview of a site that was largely incised. We put these in, raised the water table. So this has all got a high water table during the spring. This terrace now is flooded and pretty abundant riparian vegetation. So put a series of these in, raised the water table up, grew a lot of riparian vegetation, getting a pretty good fish response. In this system, we have steelhead. And so we've taken a fairly simplified system and helped to make it more complex. This shows the sequence in another reach where we put in beaver dam analogs, and then there were beaver in the system, so they started working it. But we took, over the course of 5 years, we took a system that was really just this somewhat sinuous but pretty simple channel, very narrow channel, and we created a lot more complexity. It shows in 2011, here's what it looked like in 2011, 2012, you see with beaver coming in and working the system, and us putting in a few more structures, we were able to get some more complexity. In 2013, a little bit more, and then 2014, what you're looking at on the big screen. So really this process of recovery, it's a little different than sort of a standard restoration approach where you might just simply put in a structure, call it done like a piece of wood, and you walk out. This is more of a a relationship with a system with actually the organisms in it. And so you're working with them to try to get them to build up the system in a way that benefits, helps achieve a goal, the goals that you want. So that it's a five-year process and it's ongoing. That's 2014. We're in 2015 now. Every year we're seeing more and more things. We're seeing them colonize, the beaver colonizing more areas, the habitat getting more complex, areas that are dry and really not containing much in the way of a lot of ecosystem benefits. They're becoming conversion more into riparian areas. These are just some examples from that study where we did this. This is survival of Omicus at Steelhead. Pre-restoration, we had this is our, the control is Murder's Creek in the red, and the treatment is the blue. And so we did a classic BACI design, before after control impact. And what we saw is that before treatment, the treatment reach was really relatively lower in terms of survival. We had fewer fish surviving. Then afterwards, what we saw is a slow, not huge, and there's a lot of variation, but we saw survival increasing. So, and survival, for those of you that don't know, for in terms of fish, that's the gold standard. If we can increase survival, that is year or season to season increase in survival, we're getting more fish. More fish are surviving and they're making it out. So that's really what we want, as opposed to something like density, which is helpful, but that doesn't necessarily mean they're surviving. So very, very good to see. And then here's just a shot of what one of these looks like, kind of a fisheye view there. Then the other issue, I think near and dear to everybody in California, is groundwater. And what we saw here, again, with that BACI design is, sorry, it's a little hard to see. Let me get my glasses, at least I can see a little better. Prior to treatment in one of our reaches, the groundwater was decreasing slowly, and the variation is really in response to the hydrograph. Here's in the light blue below is the hydrograph, so that's the discharge of the system downstream at a gauge. And what we're seeing is generally it tracking the discharge, but overall the trend was decreasing because the system was still incising. Then we in 2009, we put in a series of structures, and we put in dozens and ultimately over 100 structures of beaver dam analogs, and what we saw was slowly over time a slow increasing trend in terms of groundwater levels. So very, very encouraging to see that. And that trend is continuing. This is just through 2012, and again, there's been a few more years of data, and that trend is increasing. Here's another one. This is actually in a natural system, but we did a forward-looking infrared survey of some beaver ponds, and what we saw was this. This tells you what the surface temperature is, and what you can see. Here's the beaver pond. The dams illustrated by the green lines, is that we saw a lot of the purple, which is indicative of cooler temperatures. So that's temperatures that are in the high teens and degrees Celsius. And then a lot of warm temperatures as well. In contrast, over to the right here is a section, and you can see pictures of it below what they look like, that didn't have beaver ponds, and it was pretty much uniformly high temperatures. So not much good habitat. Now, the interesting thing from a regulatory standpoint, if you're looking at the volume or area of water quality violations, 303D exceedances, you've actually got quite a bit more here, but you've also got this cooler plume, and of course that's where the fish are. So we've created a system where fish can now thrive where they couldn't before, but we've also created a lot more habitat that isn't necessarily good. So from a, it's just interesting from a regulatory perspective, because if you were out putting your temperature probes in there, you'd say, well, you've created a lot more habitat that exceeds our Clean Water Act code. At the same time, we've created other good habitat. So and through this process-based approach, so how we, regulate or what we think of that or deal with that in the regulatory framework is I guess, an interesting, not entirely intellectual exercise. This is just a plan view of a beaver dam showing kind of how the cooling effects work. And what we're getting is there's a lot of hyperreic or subsurface flow path. This just shows kind of a little cartoon of it. But the interesting data is on the lower right, where what we saw is up in the main stem, and then in the open water of in the main stem below the dam, and the open water of the main pond, we saw pretty high temperatures, and this is just for a period in August and September. But down below, we saw areas where there was cool upwelling, illustrated over here, and what you see is pretty constant cool temperatures. So we're creating a lot more heterogeneity, and we're creating opportunities for fish to thrive, even though the general environment might not be favorable everywhere, and prior to the beaver being there, it certainly was favorable nowhere. Okay, so that's beaver. So let's talk about wood jams, because when we're talking about obstructions to flow and sediment, wood jams certainly come into play, and here's just one example of many. There's been some work, Rocco Fiore up northwest and the Klamath system has put obstructing wood jams, and this is just an example, showing that they have similar effects in terms of accumulating both wood, and then that wood obstructs the movement of sediment, and so you can get aeration and multi-threaded channel and kind of some of these stage zero attributes. Other people have done that too, the log steps. This is from a project actually in the Matol, where they're really trying to raise groundwater levels and get some of this complex habitat, get the groundwater near to the surface so that you can have riparian vegetation become established. And there's also just flow deflection devices, which aren't complete obstructions, but they do retain sediment and material. Here's a channel-spanning log jam, and then here's just an example to the right, upper right, of just a natural wood jam, and sort of there's a number of examples where these things have formed, and it's just been documented some of the effects that you get in terms of these ecological benefits. And then this is just a reminder that really process-based restoration, it's restoring processes. That is, we're altering sediment and water transport rates. We're not managing for a specific habitat type in a specific location for any length of time. This just shows, an example where you've got a lowered water table here. You put in a obstruction, in this case just a couple of logs. You've got some increased hyperbaric flow. You've reconnected this channel. But then over to the right, so you're thinking, okay, well, that's all well and good. We've raised the water table. We've got a pond. Yay. But to your right, this shows you the sequence here where you've got before installation, here's what it looks like. Afterwards, you've got a deep pool upstream, a plunge pool below, maybe a little hyperbaric flow. Then it fills up with sediment. And so now you've got hyperbaric exchange and maybe cool water upwelling here, but you don't have your pool. And so things change over time. In the case of, say, beaver dams in particular, then that dam might be abandoned. It might degrade. You don't have you've got a single thread channel. And then you might have them coming back again a little while later, building a pond. And so we see this system that's going through any one particular location is going through a sequence of events or successional process that might include being riparian vegetation, a single thread channel, multi-thread channel, ponded environment, oxbow lake, et cetera. The idea is to get the system moving rather than focusing on a specific habitat type. Then this is a lot of detail here, but this really gives a sense of, given if your target is a stage zero channel, that you have to ask what types of structures are appropriate given your location. So again, this is a lot of detail, but you've got here on your on the top here, you've got a number of different common or not so common obstruction types that you might use in restoration. And then here you have locations, and it's just broken into low gradient habitat, medium gradient, and high gradient. And then low gradient habitat's broken down into a number of different habitat types. One of the things about restoration in general is that most of the really beneficial stream habitat restoration occurs in low gradient habitat. So you can break that down into confined, entrenched, unconfined, et cetera, main stem tributaries. And then you can get a sense using this matrix of what types of restoration actions are appropriate for a given particular environment. Then you can also take all that information, and again going to the Y or the upper rows is that you can look at the different types in the context of various different habitat types, and you can ask yourself, what kind of benefits are you going to get? So that helps to drive it too. So knowing where you are in the landscape and knowing what goals you're looking at in terms of what you want to achieve, and this is using coho as an example of the habitat types you might want to create, that helps guide what's appropriate and what to do and what kind of work you want to be considering. Okay, so we talked about two types of dams, really, beaver dams and large wood. Just want to point out that you can scale these concepts up. And so you've got beaver dams. We didn't talk about live vegetation a lot, but you've also got other options, levee setbacks as an option, landslides, alluvial fans, sea level rise, and then tectonics. And all of these things, you might not think of them as a restoration tool, but all of these have similar effects to what we've just talked about, but they're just operating at a different scale. And the key functions are that they're increasing flow resistance, they're lowering slope, they're reducing stream power per unit width. So fundamental to it is really those three key points. So here's just some examples. We'll just go through these quickly, but levee removal can recreate stage zero systems if channel is at greater perch. And then inside systems, flow sediment obstructions can accelerate habitat recovery. But again, just something simple that gives a system room to move. Landslides, again, not necessarily a popular or common restoration mechanism, but it's worth noting that they have the same effect. And this is just an example of the Nile Valley landslide in Washington, part of the Stanford landslide complex. And here it shows, is a little bigger scale, and the circle showing you where it is. And what it's done is it's created this alluvial valley upstream. So that happens to be an area that's really high productivity in terms of salmon habitat. And so we've got a system that the best habitat in the system is driven by a landslide. And then Chris May, my colleagues, looked at this in more detail and really did a lot of analysis and found that most of the good salmon habitat in the mountains of central Oregon were created by landslides. So you've got this process of obstruction to flow and sediment. You've got an accumulation of sediment. You get the formation. So essentially, alluviation is another way to think of a stage zero channel. You're creating an alluvial valley floor with an elevated water table. So then talk about sea level. That's the ultimate dam. And you might not think about sea level as a dam, but it has the same effect. It's slowing the flow of sediment and water. And most of our really complex systems, that's that's why I call it the ultimate dam, is that you can't go any lower. You can't incise below sea level, right? So that has created a lot of complex systems. And that's important because, well, here's another shot. Here's the Mackenzie River, Taku River, these really complex systems that have developed. Yukon River, all complex stage zero systems, just amazing systems. And then I would say that looking at the historic maps of the Sacramento and San Joaquin Rivers 150 years before present were also like this. This is a little close-up showing what some of the sites look like. But, you know, I think most of you probably know that it was a fairly complex ecosystem, really a stage system, a lot of channels, a lot of wetlands, extensive wetlands, and really more of a wetland river complex. So another again, was formed by sea level as the ultimate sort of grade control there. Okay, then the other one is tectonic dams, and this is an example of the Scott River in the Klamath Basin. And this one's worth pointing out because this is one of the best coho streams in the state. And of course, the coho salmon are a CESA and ESA listed species. And what's interesting is that all of this low gradient habitat, this was formerly known as Beaver Valley, by the way, but all of this low gradient habitat that is formed by the presence of the accumulation of sediment here, and that's occurring because this uplift in this region right here is more rapid than the downcutting caused by by erosion from precipitation. If you go over here to the left, a nice comparative photo would be helpful here, but you go to the Salmon River, that gets considerably more rainfall, similar geology, but it's considerably more rainfall. It is cut down through. It doesn't have a nice valley. This is a nice valley, lots of agriculture, a lot of productivity. It doesn't have that because its tectonic dam doesn't exist because it was eroded through. So just a slight change, or not too slight, but a change in precipitation has had tremendous effects on the erosion rates, and that has had tremendous effects on the valley forming processes or valley retaining processes, and that has had tremendous effects on the availability of habitat for coho salmon. So here's some other examples of just geologic controls. Again, the Okavango River in Botswana, the Sud Swamp, these aren't controlled by sea level, but they have geologic controls. So again, just giving you an idea of the extent. Okay, so then I jump to sea level rise, and the reason I mentioned sea level rise is because I call it a grade changer. This is a nice, hopeful picture here. What happens if all the ice melts? It's from National Geographic from a couple of years ago, and here's the Central Valley, and what you can see is that 200-foot melting or sea level rise is going to inundate most of the valley. We're at about 30 feet elevation, I think, right here. There's the sea level rises in the next 85 years, that is by 2100, which isn't that far away, is 1 to 3 meter rise. And what's happening as we're moving along and learning more and more about, primarily the ice melting, is that there's a number of mechanisms we don't understand. And as the ones we are learning about, what we're finding is that the ice is melting much more quickly than we anticipated. So most of our models are conservative. And as we get more and more information, we're finding that the sea level rise is tending to be accelerating more than we anticipate. So 200 feet, that might be 5,000 years out, but in the big context of things, in the rise and fall of civilizations, it's within that scale. The other point I want to make here is that this is big stuff, right? I mean, this is big stuff, but the Central Valley is really important to agriculture around the world, and it's really something that we need to be thinking about in terms of how do we deal with this oncoming event. One of the things to keep in mind is I think most of you know that the Central Valley is subsiding due to groundwater withdrawals. It's also subsiding because there's not a lot of sediment coming in because of a lot of the dams. So really thinking about sediment as a resource, and in this context is to begin thinking, and we have some time here, but to begin thinking about how we get sediment accumulating in the Central Valley to counteract some of that sea level rise so that we still have a functional agricultural economy. Either that or you just say, well, now become a nice inland sea, and I guess that has some ecological value. But it's something that we can plan for if we choose to. So I just kind of leave you with this thought. And in terms of dams, that people are trying to address sea level rise right now. And what you see here are two shots. One's of Venice, where they're putting in tide barriers in each of these systems right here, these openings to the lagoon, because this Venice is getting knocked out by storm surges. Similarly, in Russia, St. Petersburg, the upper right, they've got a 16-mile dam, essentially, that's to keep storm surges out of their bay because St. Petersburg, has been hit so many times by floods, and it's becoming very costly. So I just throw out for thinking, and it might be future generations that are really thinking about this, but given the way things are going, I think that pretty soon we're going to be talking about in Carquinez Strait whether or not we need to put some sort of sea level barrier there. I think that, as crazy as that might sound, I think that that's sort of the direction things are heading in the world, and so we need to be thinking about, how do we permit it? One, is it a good idea? And what are the consequences, and how would it be managed? And in this case, given the groundwater withdrawals and sort of what's going on hydrologically in the Central Valley, there's also an argument to be made that something like that could be used for groundwater recharge. So you'd be keeping saltwater out, but you also might be increasing the amount of flood time in some of these areas, and thus increasing the availability of water for the time, other times of year. So it's something to think about. There's obviously an amazing political element to this, and there's a number, there's a big economy there. The sense of the delta certainly provides a lot of food and such, but it's the scale of some of the things we need to look at if we're going to kind of maintain our agricultural systems and our ecological systems. So big, big stuff. So I leave you, I guess, actually with this one. I think maybe a couple more slides, but looking at that map of California, you ask, is this a map of the past or a blueprint for the future, or is it both? I mentioned that the delta is currently sinking, and we're running out of groundwater. We've got 1,000, 2,000 feet deep wells right now, and there's a lot of subsidence. There's a lot of problems with that. And so, you know, there's that saying or the bumper sticker that says no farms, no food, but also, you know, no water, no farms. And if you have no sediment, you have no farmland. So really thinking about how we manage our sediment and our water and sort of some of these long-term views and really thinking about the consequences of them, because we've come onto this landscape. We've been here for roughly 150 years. We've made tremendous changes and alterations to these processes that unfold over millennia. And so thinking about these long-term processes and working with them, I think that there's a lot of opportunity there, but we do need to, I think, change the way we think. And it's sort of in the context in stream management, there's been a lot of management for floods. So we have floods are bad, we have to do something, and that's led to a lot of this incision, channel straightening, lowering of water tables, because we want to grow things on the land, right? But I think that in a sense, though, in the big scale, that floods are inconvenient, but droughts, that is running out of water or poorly managing their agricultural areas, that's what actually takes out civilizations. So that's sort of history. There's a great book, I think it's just called Water, Steve Solomon wrote it, but he just goes through and looks at the hydraulic societies from the Sumerians on up and just looking at what knocked them out, why they collapsed, and it was typically because they didn't manage their water and sediment resources very well. So, you know, we have an opportunity to learn from past civilizations, and we have the knowledge and the understanding of how to manage these systems. And whether we have the political and regulatory infrastructure, that remains to be seen. But to me, this is our challenge as we move forward into the 21st century. So, conclusions. You can draw your own, but I'll give you a few. Sediment is a resource. We tend to think of it as a problem, something that sediment is bad, but in the process-based restoration, we look at it as a resource. No sediment, no alluvial valleys, as an example. Base flow water elevation, in terms of process-based restoration, that's a key to design feature. Where do you want to put that at? It might not want to go around the top, and we looked at a lot of pristine systems. There might be ways, and there are ways, where we can elevate it but still allow, say crop growth or crops and agricultural activities to occur on the land, but we're elevating the water table so it's not, instead of 20 feet down, it's maybe 3 feet down. So anyway, something to think about. Three components to stream restoration: sediment, water, and biota. And then keeping in mind that these processes play out at multiple spatiotemporal scales to lower stream and valley slopes, lower stream power per unit width, and that might not mean a lot to all of you, but it's a very important point, increased retention rates of both sediment and water, and ultimately I think it can benefit both fish and farmers if we can get moving in this direction. So that, I think, is it. Oh, here's the take-home messages again, because that's what everybody wants, and there's got to be three of them, right? So degraded streams have limited ecological function. The scale of restoration needs to be commensurate with the scale of the actions that cause the degradation. And I didn't talk about that a lot. I talked about the restoration time frame. The second point, really, I say that because a lot of our restoration thinking and a lot of our regulatory framework really allows for what I would call very small scale restoration that doesn't address the underlying fundamental problems, because it doesn't come at it from understanding it from a stream evolution model or from a process-based approach. So in the picture here, you know, we've got this degraded system, Poutah Creek. It's down cut. It used to be up here, right? The valley's flat up there because there was a stream up there. I don't know when that happened, maybe 10,000 years ago, maybe 100 years ago. It cut down, and now it's got an inset floodplain. We don't know when that happened either, but now it's at the elevation it's at. Now, from a process-based approach, we would look at that and say, let's see if we can build it, bring that back up. Let's see if we can find areas for reconnect it to this, maybe ultimately get it back up here. But a lot of what we do is work within this degraded system with very little ecological value, with not an awareness of what sort of trajectory we want the whole system to work on. So a lot of restoration projects might say, go, oh, look at that bank. Let's put a bank stabilization project and control the sediment there. Or you might put a piece of wood in and say, let's build a little pool for fish. And that isn't, from experience, what we're finding is that isn't the kind of restoration that actually leads to substantial improvement in habitat such that we get recovery of a population of species. That the scale at which we need to address restoration is the scale at which we cause problems. And so whether it's diking, dredging, gold mining, there's some great examples of just gold mining that's just laid waste to whole systems. We have to come in with the tools and really look at it from a geomorphic perspective and alter the processes, the geomorphic, the hydrogeomorphic processes at the scale that we cause the problem, or we're really not going to get to where we need to get, and these species are not likely to survive. So I think that's it. Okay. That's all on that. I didn't know the exact structure of this, but I thought one of the issues that have come up is really, and some people asked me about this, was, well, okay, this is all well and good. You know, we drink the Kool-Aid, process-based restoration, stage zero channel, yay, beavers, all that. What do we do in terms of the regulatory framework? Because it's not set up, if you think of this as an experiment, it's not set up very well in general to do experiments. It's not set up for process-based restoration. We're very good at allowing structures but not processes. So we can regulate structures but not processes, whether they go in or don't go in. Lastly is that we're really, I don't think, very well set up. Our environmental laws really came at the regulate or at protection from a let's get regulations in there to keep things from getting worse. Like, we've got pollution, we've got clean water issues. Let's stop bad things from happening. And here we are saying, you know what? The bad things happen. We're in a degraded system. We need to actually change the whole fundamental system and build it back up. And the system is not set up to do that and to permit it. So if you look at the language, the regulatory language, if you look at your CEQA document or NEPA, but you know, we're in California, so CEQA, it is designed to prevent adverse environmental effects. If you look at your 1600 rules, it's designed to prevent adverse or mitigate for adverse environmental effects. And so they're not set up to say, how do we promote good things on the landscape? What if there's good things that we want to do? It's really set up from a very defensive posture, and a lot of us in the regulatory community and regulatory agencies are really kind of forced into that. So this transition into a regulatory framework that not just allows for but encourages restoration at this scale, restoration of processes, these temporal and spatial scales. That's what I guess I would put to you as whether or not you think this is a good idea. Now let's just assume you do think it's a good idea for now. What do you see as the obstacles and some of the challenges, and how do we move forward within the existing framework right now? So with that, I'll take questions, or I'll ask you some more questions.
So if you guys want to participate, just raise your hand. I'll bring the microphone over, and this is so that the people on the webinar can hear you as well. And then if you are on the webinar, you can type anything into the chat box, and we will read it.
Oh, there we go. Let's see. I think I lost my thought here. In terms of the regulatory framework, it seems like Washington State enacted some laws to create watershed councils where they had to, you know, look at the entire watershed, do a watershed analysis. And that hasn't happened here in California. I'm with NIMS, by the way. I'm a regulator. I'm from the Washington Restoration Community when I came here, and so I saw some, you know, sense of dearth. I was kind of shocked at how little had been done on the watershed scale, but the geomorphic processes in California and the focus of how to restore fish has been, you know, completely different. It's more about temperature and flow. In Washington State, it's more about now the entire ecosystem. So is that your experience as well? Is that, you know, the regulations in Washington and Oregon are a little bit more watershed process friendly, and maybe you could give us some input on how we could boost that in California? I mean, that's kind of what I feel like we're up against. Maybe the new restoration dollars should have some caveats with them. Anyway.
No, it's a good question. I think both California and Oregon have been fortunate. I mean, there's a couple of things, is that the politics are very different. In Washington and Oregon, salmon is really much more of a cultural icon. There's Native American tribes, there's people, there's families, generations that have grown up fishing, and it's just a bigger part of the cultural landscape. In California, I grew up, you know, it's a lot, the politics are really fun. They're very vibrant in California, and people feel very passionate about things. And I think, and for whatever reason, perhaps because Washington tended to be more colonized by the Norwegians, I don't know, but it kind of has a history. People talk about the Seattle way, and people get together and they talk, and they kind of work in a more collaborative, cooperative fashion. And I, you know, you need a sociologist. I'm just speculating, you know, maybe it's just, it's dark and depressing up there more, and that somehow brings people together. I don't know, but you know, California is a big, vibrant economy. It's huge. I mean, at one time it was the fifth largest in itself in the world. So everything is very big here, and I think that plays into it. And then the fact that salmon are really important in the north, and then you go further south, and they're extirpated, and they're just not as big a player. So I just don't think it's been on people's radar as much. So that might be part of the reason. I don't know why, though, that we haven't had more of a, here in California, more of a sense of watershed. And maybe it's because there's a lot of flat in the watershed. It's the Sacramento, and it's huge, and you can't relate to it. I don't know, but there definitely is more. You see signs up there. You see people entering the blah, blah, blah watershed, and there's watershed councils and communities, and people really have a sense of the fish that are in a particular area, and they have pride in it. And there's education, and you got Sammy the Salmon, a little, big paper mache thing that kids can go climb in, and there's just a lot of outreach at multiple levels. I think also there's been, at the regulatory level, there's been a lot of effort on our agency and other agencies to really interact at the state level and to have seminars, workshops, to really bring really kind of ongoing continuing ed, although it's not called that, it's more continuing legal ed, that's more of a requirement for lawyers, but even that, I've gone and given talks to legal audiences and discussed, and so I think there's just been a more effort to really get everybody understanding what the issue is and really kind of rolling up the sleeves and figuring out how to solve the problem. That's, you know, why that is, I don't know, but I do feel here you tend to see more of an adversarial relationship. And it's more, people are more comfortable in that position, and I don't know why. Anybody have any insights? I don't know. Any sociologists here? Yeah, yes. You need the microphone, or I can repeat the question if you.
Sorry, where was the question?
I think one of the issues in California is that, land use and population density. I'm having a hard time thinking of any of the watersheds that I work on, or rivers that I work on, that I could really take a full process-based approach and restore processes, whether it be because of ag encroaching on the top of the riverbanks or and into the floodplain and levees, you know, being built along rivers, or working over in the Bay Area or down in Los Angeles where there's houses, you know, forming the river, the bank of the creek, I don't see a lot of opportunity to do a full process-based restoration. And I guess when I was thinking about scale of restoration needs to be commensurate with the scale of the degradation, I guess I wonder, you know, what you're really calling for, maybe, or what you would think you would call for in, say, a gold mine system, say the Scott River, what you would do when you have miles of dredger tailings on the side of the creek.
Well, that's a great example. Well, first of all, yeah, another way to frame this in a geomorphological context is talking about continuity management versus discontinuity management. And typically, stream restoration, especially in urban areas, has focused on continuity management. And that means to if you're restoring a reach, all the sediment and water that comes into that system, you kind of want to move out, right? So you don't want accumulation. You're not using sediment as a resource. You're saying, oh, my God, sediment, you know, and that aggrades the system. We're going to get more flooding, and we're on the UC Berkeley campus, and bad, you know. So absolutely, you need to look at where you are, and this is not applicable in a highly urbanized environment. But, you know, having said that, California is not, it may sound funny to say this, but it's not that urbanized. I mean, there's really an awful lot of areas. So I think where you've got mountain meadows, there's a big interest in mountain meadow restoration. You've got the whole Sierra Nevada. That's a just wide open area. You got Modoc, Lassen counties. There's big areas without a lot of people. And those are the areas where you would focus and where you're going to get a big bang for your buck. From a restoration perspective, those are going up the coast, in the context of California, that's a coastal coho, going up the coast, where there's more room to maneuver and for these processes to unfold, much better use of resources than trying to go into a heavy urbanized environment and spending all this money on permitting and engineering and all this stuff when you're not really getting much. You're in a degraded system. You're going to only make it, you know, if you go back to that diagram, you're going to make it take it from a 1 to a 2. You know, you're going to get this much better. And then if you go to a system up on the northern coast or go and work with a private timber company or something like that. Was it Green Diamond Timber? You've got a big landowner with a big land base, and you've got an opportunity to do some of this stuff. And you can get a lot more habitat in terms of population recovery. You're going to get a lot more coho salmon for your buck if you focus on areas like that. So I see a lot of opportunities, but they're not in the Bay Area. And then, you know, there's a lot of interest. So there you've got more. But even there you've got East Bay Municipal Utility District. There are places. And so I think you're not necessarily going to get the full Mackenzie River kind of thing going. You know, we're probably a long ways off from doing anything, in the Delta at that scale. But you can do some. There's some areas, there's some places, there's some reserves, and in those areas, you know, there's parks, there's play. I mean, I've certainly seen plenty of places where you can do that. And one of the things that we're doing right now is developing a beaver intrinsic potential model, which is roughly a stage zero model, but not quite. So we could adapt it. And just to show in California where beaver could occur in the landscape. And it's reach by reach. It's not really accurate at that scale, but it will give a sort of a HUC-12, if you're familiar with the hydrologic unit codes. It'll give a sense of, here's areas where there's a lot of low gradient habitat with valleys that are wide enough for beaver to build dams, and where you could do some of the stuff. You've still got the landowner issues. But the landowner issues, part of what we're seeing is because of the drought, they're going, hey, well, you know, getting some water out of the deal, that's not so bad. They might lose a little bit of land, and that is the trade-off. If you bring the system up, it's so you're losing land, you're gaining water. That's an individual basis. There's some places, in Idaho, where they call it sub-irrigation, where they've got beaver coming in primarily, and they're raising the water table, but the slope is such that you know, they're flooding a certain amount. They just dedicate a certain amount of their land for conservation purposes. But what it has is this effect of flooding the whole valley. These guys don't have to water their crops. They're getting much higher yields. So even though they're setting aside land for conservation, it's basically groundwater recharge, and they're getting their productivity off of the remaining area. So some of it is just talking through, getting people on board, getting an example here and there, and then somebody talks to their friends, and you know, there's a community of people out there. And so that's what's happening right now in California, which is pretty exciting. And there's places that where there are ranchers, farmers that are interested in doing this because they understand. You want to go talk to a bunch of farmers, you're talking to a bunch of PhDs in hydrology. I mean, they know water because they depend on it. So they get the hydrologic processes. They may or may not care about the fish, but you know, I think in my experience, working the hydrologic processes is really one of the better ways to get landowners on board. The fish, it helps in the context of ESA, regular CISA regulations that, you know, if you get good habitat in there, you get a habitat conservation plan to put in good habitat like this, then that allows them to do stuff elsewhere. So you negotiate agreements and stuff. San Francisco, you know, other than the maybe the reservoirs. I don't know.
Hi, Michael.
Hi,
Betsy. Thank you for your presentation. I just, like Margie mentioned, about private landowners, and it's been my experience that if the department was going to present an idea that, okay, we're going to do this and you're going to lose some of your land, they'd want to be compensated somehow for that. And it's not just the water, because we don't really know if it's going to work or not, right? So I just wanted to, that thought came to mind. And then as the public lands in California, so the forests and BLM land, those would be, or even parks, there's demonstration forests in Humboldt County or Mendocino County where they do experiments in streams. And I think those would be appropriate places to concentrate, because they're public lands and you probably wouldn't have the permitting issues. So anyway, I just want to mention that.
Yeah, no, that's good. I did remind me, though, you had asked, it's Margie, is that right?
Yeah,
Margie. You'd asked about the Scott Valley and the tailings. And that's a great example. That's about, I think, about a 5-mile stretch where they just did bucket dredging and just turned the whole system upside down to get gold about 50 feet down. And so you've got this interesting system where you've got fine sediment, about 40 feet of fine sediment now, on the bottom, and then you've got this cobble, primarily cobble overburden, and all the water enters it at the top, and during the summer it goes subsurface. It just, obviously the cobble doesn't hold much in the water. So it's just this barren landscape. It happened a half century ago, and it's still pretty barren. There's not a lot of vegetation. There's not a lot of geomorphic development in terms of habitat. So that's a great area where you'd really want to look at it, you know, going in there and putting in a few planting of riparian trees or something or wood isn't really going to do it. You're going in there and really thinking about how you're going to reshape the fundamental hydrologic processes primarily, so that some of the geomorphic processes, especially sediment, fine sediment deposition, which that's an example where you really need the fine sediment to drop out on the floodplain and channel, because it's just all dropping down. So. But it's interesting that you say that, because we're looking at that right now for the very reasons of people wanting water, wanting salmon habitat restored, and wanting access to some of that water. So I think that's a great example. But it would be really exciting to be able to use these principles there. And I think that they can be applied, and they're looking at how to do that. And there's a lot of complex local politics in that particular instance, which makes it interesting, But that's an area where I think is just a great candidate. How could you make it worse is what I've repeatedly said, and I don't know. I guess there's probably a way, but I certainly think using these principles would have pretty good habitat there, politics willing.
So you have a question from your online audience. In confined channels, is there any benefit to modifying large woody debris jams if they're blocking a significant reach of coho habitat for over a decade?
Seems like a loaded question, doesn't it? This is a hypothetical, right? I think that actually, I had a series of kind of questions along those lines because in terms of hypothetical regulatory questions, and that's a great one. I think for all of these, we are caught in the regulatory environment with sort of these short-term impacts versus long-term gains. And so that particular, I don't know nothing about it or what's going on, and you'd really have to do a site-specific analysis, but it is a good example of something where you might have really good habitat forming in the long term, but in the short term you've got this coho blockage. So it could be a short-term detriment. The question, though, really can't be asked or answered, really can be asked, not answered, without understanding what's the availability of habitat in the area. If there's not a lot of habitat available, then it becomes an issue. If there's lots of other habitat, for them, it's not so much of an issue.
So there is a follow-up. This occurred in Elk River, Humboldt Bay.
Elk River and Humboldt Bay. Okay. That still doesn't tell me anything. I mean, my understanding of most of the coho populations is that they're well below capacity. So whether that particular jam is causing a significant population level effect or whether the fish are able to go elsewhere, I don't know. But certainly if there's, a historic presence of coho and there's a pretty clear evidence that that's causing a decrease in the coho population, then that has to be considered, whether you want to make that accessible to coho upstream or whether you want to let the natural processes play out on their own and let that incised stream eventually find a path through, around, over. But the redwoods are pretty big up there. I could see that lasting a while. And so but it actually really speaks to the decentralization of decision making, the importance of that, because the only way you can really answer that question is if you have people that understand the geomorphology of the system, the hydrology of the system, the land use history of the system, and the fish population. And so really it's a question that really begs for a local solution and someone or people or peoples that have an understanding of the processes in there. But I mean, I'm personally comfortable with it either way, depending on what a group of people make, but giving, I think, control to the local control is something that is very helpful in that instance, because they're, I think, going to be the ones that are going to be able to make that informed decision.
You had another quick question about what was the title of the book you mentioned earlier, Water and Civilization Demise?
I think it's just Water. It's Steve Solomon. It's cheery. Fortunately, it's not nonfiction or not fiction. By the way, can you just for my edification, give me your names as you're speaking? So
sure, my name is Terry Jackson, and I'm looking at your bullet points there for your take-home messages. Seems that number 2 and number 3. Are somewhat in conflict, in that most of the stuff we have, the scale is huge, and most of the work we do, according to number 1, is pretty much limited, but it's always a band-aid to prevent extinction, which is essentially failing.
Right, poorly applied band-aid.
Yeah, and so you have so you end up with a lot of challenges with you're looking at a system such as the gentleman or lady that put in the comment about this 10-foot log jam or whatever, again, obviously, one of the processes is the backfill from that possibly or whatever. But again, you got all these complexes. It means you may have a system like this one you're showing in the picture where, I don't know if that's a 10 or 15 foot subbank that you would want to build into for starters. Well, that's going to require at a minimum, you know, some, whether you put in log jams or whatever it is at 4 foot at a time. You're trying to do something at a relative scale in a time frame that would do any good, yet you have a problem with maybe passage or whatever, not to pick on, you know, NOAA nymphs or whatever, but if you got a situation on the short term where, you know, you have to maintain 6-inch jumping for a juvenile fish, well, 6 inches at a time is going to take forever.
Yeah.
So, again, I just was, it's more of a comment than a question, that, you know, one of
the... I think that's this is great because this gets to the heart of it, which is how do we rebuild these systems while providing the services, however diminished, that they do provide. And so in that example, the 6-inch rule, for those of you that aren't familiar with it, is the jump height that typical for most state agencies, California state agencies, that if any obstruction in a river can't have more than 6-inch hydraulic jumps, so from one elevation to the next, so a step. And that that's our regulations, my agencies, and that was done on some studies. And so that was really designed in the context of culverts. And what's happened is that that has been applied to other obstructions, inclusive of beaver dams and wood jams and stuff. So that's the case really where I think there's an opportunity there to review and really reconsider the appropriateness of that because fish generally can jump over heights that are greater than that. In fact, David White just did a study where he was looking at the difference in success of coho juveniles, and there was 12 inches was working just fine. The other issue embedded in that is this idea that I think it's California law actually says, you know, that all streams must be passable to all fish at all life stages at all times, or at least that's how it's been told to me. And so some of that requires, so you could just take that on its face value, right? And you could say that's the rule and that we have to do that. So we need to make all our streams highways for fish and not focus on perhaps homes for them, as it were. But there's a sort of a reasonableness to such an interpretation or such a rule, which is a fish likely to be in the river at that time? And so do you need to have it be passable to a fish if they're not likely to be moving that time of the year, or if they're not likely to be in the river at that time of the year, or that part of the system? So I think that some of this, that's some of the challenges that you really need, and it goes belly back to going back to your experts that are on the ground that understand how your particular fish population is behaving in that system, because there are specific times of year that fish do move, and you want to have the flows adequate to allow, say, upstream movement of juvenile salmon to cooler water, or downstream out-migration, or upstream spawning movement. And those are, a lot of those are very flow-dependent, and a lot of fish, no surprise, are triggered to respond to flow. So I think that there's room within the understanding of how fish actually utilize a system to interpret those rules such that we can have structures that create the habitat that they need while allowing for passage at the critical times that they need to move. And then bearing in mind that fish don't need, especially with a depressed population, they don't need access to everything, and that barriers are a natural part of the environment. And going back to beaver dams and wood jams, those are a natural part of the environment. There were obstructions in places. So the idea that all of our streams might not be passable to all fish at all times isn't going to drive them to extinction. It's quite the contrary. We need some of these obstructions so we have, in particular for coho, the slow water habitat so they can escape the floods and they have a place to go during, especially in the winter. We're creating this habitat so that they can live and thrive. So there's a bit of a trade-off there, but I think that, again, you didn't ask a question, it's just a comment, is that I think that the challenge for us is to figure out how we can interpret some of those rules rather than in a black and white or sort of a textbook or cookbook approach, that we can really develop a way that we can rely on the local understanding of the physical processes in that in a particular area and the biological processes, because that's, going back to the Washington example, that's what really seems to help, having watershed councils, groups of people that really know the local environment and making kind of a very collaborative group decision on it, and recognizing that there isn't one answer. You can't prescribe it, and so you've really got to be very context specific. You didn't answer a question, so I don't have to ask if I answered it.
Well then I'll ask a question.
What was your name again?
I'm Terry.
Terry Jackson.
Yes, that's right. So ultimately, again, when you talk about restoration, the word restore means to put back to something. One of the challenges I see in a lot of meetings, et cetera, is nobody seems to have a goal as to what restore means. So they just want to this, we're going to restore everything. Well, does that mean you're going to restore it to 1800? You're going to restore it to 1940? Where are you going to restore it to, and what's realistic? As Mary's mentioned, farmers aren't excited about restoring it back to 1800 or whatever, because that would mean, I grew up in Oregon, that would mean that a lot of the land would be underwater. So you got a point of, well, okay, if we're going to restore it back and we're going to raise the water table, and then some people are going to be upset about the raising of water table to restore things. So what do you see as a reasonable point where you can restore something to improve water table, improve water habitat, the habitat for the fish? And essentially you're looking for this fine line between ultimately, in my opinion, would be that you do something big, restore something big, short-term pain as far as the fish can access something. Let's say it's 4-foot jumps, backfilling bringing the water table up, say, 4 feet. It may take 10 years for that fish to have access to that, or 5 years, or whatever the process is. Or do you say you just continue to fix this at 12 inches at a time or whatever? Which way do you see it?
I think that there's a compromise in between there. So obviously we're not, if we've got agricultural activities, we're not going to get something that looks like the Mackenzie River Basin or the Yukon. But like I said, that there's opportunities in a degraded system to get some of that habitat back. And so you've got different landowners with different tolerances for conservation or riparian width. And so you work with the landowners that are interested or willing to set that aside. And not everybody's driven by just pushing up ag lands right up to the edge. There are a lot, but it changes, And so again, this gets into the educational process. And really, I don't want to sound like a broken record, but local control not just local land owners, but the local regulatory, having their input and making decisions about what's best, because a lot of times it's not that people don't mind, in my experience anyway, they don't mind contributing some land to a conservation purpose, and especially if it has a benefit for them. What they really don't like is they don't like being told what to do. So working on a more voluntary basis, working with people that know them, and kind of getting it more as a land ethic is what seems to be more successful. But it is kind of one ownership at a time, and if you don't have agreement in an area with a number of people, you're limited in how much you can do. But there are some big landowners out there, and a couple miles or even a mile of reach that the cooperative landowner is really something. You can do a lot. The other thing that it brings up though is conservation easement. And that's a big thing. There's a lot of people that are struggling with farmland, and they're trying to keep it. So a conservation easement is one way to go. And then there's just outright purchases. New Nature Conservancy's bought ag lands up in the Shasta River, and so that's an opportunity. So it's really, you do have to find the willing landowners. As far as your jump height issue, we've had pretty good success right around 3 feet. 2.5 to 3 feet in terms of building structures, and that's because flows tend to go over the fish, have been able to be accessible, have an accessible, or being able to access around them. We also, in terms of the structure per se, part of the idea is just to seal up something well enough. And we didn't get into all the techniques, but to seal it up well enough that flow can go around. So instead of them, it's not a jump height. They're not doing this. And this is how fish get over existing beaver dams. And we've seen fish populations move around 2 meter high beaver dams, and they do it because the beaver back up the flow. I showed you that one shot. They back up the flow, it goes around, and that's the fish route. So they go and do that. And so that's kind of how you do the workaround. So it's not really the height exactly, it's the geomorphic condition. And sometimes you have to build up something high enough that it gets to a terrace, so you're not in that incision trench. For that 10-foot jam, maybe the solution is to go up another 10 feet so the water can go onto a terrace and work its way. But that's the workaround. And I showed you that Bridge Creek where we put in all these dams. We put in over 100, and now with the beaver that are in there, there's, I think, something like 300 dams in an 18-kilometer stretch. And we have steelhead up and down that. And we're getting such a great response. And it's really hard to quantify, actually, the response, but we're getting it. And they're able to get around those structures because when they move is when the flow is. That's what they're timed to do. It's just to move when the flows are up, and they're going around. So they're going around. They're not sitting there. They're working around. And the same thing with juveniles. It's very hard to monitor for juvenile fish movement, but from what we can tell with, say, a beaver dam, if you make it semi-permeable, to us it looks like a 3-foot step, right? And you think, oh, there's no fish passage. But you get in, to the size of a fish, they're looking at it. It's a series of little steps. And there's orifices, and there's weir flow, overflow. There's gaps in it. There's orifice flow through the branches and stuff. And then there's end flow. And so, where we've been able to monitor it, we're seeing juvenile steelhead. They're able to move back and forth past. So these are, in this case, beaver dam analogs. They're able to move back and forth over these structures or through them. We don't know how, but we're monitoring. And in some cases, they're going down for the day, and they're foraging below the dam where there's good hydraulics, and then in the evening they go up and they go into the slow water in the margins of the pond, and there's a symbolic cost, and so they do that. And so it's been pretty interesting to see, and how they do it. I mean, I don't know, what do? Dip them in radioactive material and trace their movement? They're too small to radio tag generally. It's pretty challenging, but we do know that they're able to get through. So that 6-inch jump height is sort of our version of what we think is right for a culvert, for a beaver dam, for semi-permeable structures, for complex structures with multiple flow paths. It's not really relevant. But that's sort of where the regulations are right now. So.
Hello, my name is Jun Gohoshi, and I'm from department here, and landscape conservation planner. So first of all, I really like to appreciate your process dynamic approach. Actually, it is really difficult to find good reference source to addressing dynamic connecting to the species related issue. So I'm really looking for more information like that. So this is very helpful. It's a great step, I think. Especially addressing dynamics and complexity has been pretty challenging for me. I work for State Wildlife Action Plan, and we did all different kind of watershed conservation planning, terrestrial, aquatic, and every time we address dynamic and complexity, either water or climate, it's very challenging. So I can see, this process, your research process is going to help going to other steps. So I just wanted to appreciate that a lot. And that leads to the question about, setting up planning for short-term goals and long-term goals. And to do that, we need to have some actual monitoring, good monitoring going on, especially if you're focusing on abiotic changes. We need to see the response from the biotic. And I'm just more of a request, but somehow realistic monitoring process, including adaptable management, is, unavoidable because it's very location specific, response specific, weather all those kind of unpredictable elements specific. So this is more a request, but I just want to encourage you what you do. And
Thank you. Yeah, I'm glad you appreciate it. I think that your point about monitoring really is a good one. And ultimately what we're talking about is the short-term risk for a long-term benefit. And so the way that we address that is, well, first of all, by assessing the risk, how much risk is there? So, you know, is it really likely that there's going to be a significant population level impact if this stream isn't accessible to fish in the middle of summer when there's no flows downstream anyway? You know, I mean, just as an example, you say, okay, no low risk, all right, we're not going to worry about it. But if you're not sure about the level of risk or you think that it might be significant, the way to address that is through monitoring. So monitoring reduces risk, so because risk is uncertainty, so if you're monitoring, you're increasing your certainty. And so in this case, a specific example I'm thinking, up north in Northern California, we're monitoring fish use to demonstrate these very concepts we were just talking about, that yes, fish are able to move. And because we're not concerned about whether fish can cross something all the time everywhere, right? We're concerned about, is the population doing well? That's the scale of the response, you know, not the individual. I mean, I get in trouble, I say, because I work for NOAA, so close yours. I say, you know, fish die. I mean, and Sean Hayes said the same thing, fish die, get over it. Especially young fish, a lot of them die. And the point isn't really to keep every single fish alive or not kill them during in a particular reach, but is to get a habitat condition so that a healthy population can thrive. And so in the example I'm thinking of, we've been monitoring the fish, and it's been a struggle from permitting. There's a lot of issues around monitoring fish, and especially in ESA-listed fish. But what we're seeing is a nice, it looks like a pretty good response. In this particular instance, Mary will note Sugar Creek, last year, you know, we put in two beaver dam analogs, and last year, while we were putting them in, it was very depressing that the river went dry. And it was a bad year, you know, it dried up. Well, this, and then down below, this is in this tailings reach in Scott Valley, and you know, it goes dry for 5 miles below, so the whole area dried up. Well, this year when we put these structures in, they would visually appear to be fish blockages, but when we monitor the fish in there, and we, you know, again, it's not perfect, it's not the perfect study I want, but when we monitor them, what we see is, first of all, there's water there that stayed all year. It's the only place that has water. You go below the system and it dries up. It goes all subsurface. So the only flowing water we have in that area is right within the beaver pond and then right below where we've got hyperreic upwelling, we're pretty sure. So we look at that. Now, within that context, we see fish above the first structure, fish above the second structure, moving downstream, and fish below both structures. So we see a well-distributed population of juvenile coho and steelhead in there. Now, that to me is a success because A, we've got habitat, and B, we have fish, and C, it's an endangered fish, and that's our target species, so very successful. Now, in the regulatory context, we've actually had some back and forth because of this sort of that thinking that it needs to be passable to fish at all life stages at all time. And so we're in this interesting position where we say, well, okay, we can break the dam, and that fish, those fish that are downstream in an area that might dry up, we don't know, they might die, they will be able to get upstream to this pond, but now the pond won't exist because we put the hole in, so it's all going to drain out, and so now the fish upstream are in peril. So that's why, you know, I mean, this is literally a conversation, you know, and so this, that sort of speaks to the need to have some contextual understanding to these regulations, and so that's something that is an ongoing conversation. I mean, people say, well, what do? I think having educational workshops, having this, you know, continuing kind of ongoing, it's not legal education, but, you know, professional education, so that we all understand sort of the evolving thinking of how to manage populations and habitat. But it's, I don't know if you have any suggestions, but I Yeah. Yeah, flexible. Yeah.
And there's a reason for it. So just like, thanks.
So it just,
yeah, so yeah, I'm notorious of speaking quiet, sorry. But so just like, this is a great process, and I'm glad, by the way, from the program inviting this kind of non just one species, you know, discussion. So I just want to have a conversation going on. And
yeah, and I realized when I was talking, I didn't quite answer, at least part of it was that with the monitoring, mm-hmm. we're doing that to address that perceived risk.
So yeah, exactly. Like, so the dynamic part and monitoring part has to come together. So then it becomes a, you know, management question. It becomes a planning question.
Yeah.
And feeding back to education, which is science, and this connection is very important.
Yeah, yeah. So, but one of the other challenges we're having right now is that I mentioned earlier that the regulations aren't. Those are someone down here that one had their hand up. But that the regulations aren't well set up for scientific research. So CEQA, there's kind of a scientific exemption that we kind of snuck through, but it didn't quite fit, and you know. And sort of when you've got people that don't necessarily understand all these processes and maybe some of them are new to the job or stuff, you don't have a kind of overall intellectual framework within the regulatory community for allowing experimentation and addressing risk through monitoring and really even doing a risk assessment. So all of these are tools that we can use to move forward with recovery. And you know, but yeah, I mean, here we are. You know, but we're where we are right now, so we need to keep doing more of this. So.
Hi, my name's Chris, and I actually wanted to address this question first to Mary. Mary, did I understand that fish passage over the dams on Sugar Creek was a concern for the permitting of that project? For Sugar Creek on, yes. So it was a question, all right. But I think the point is that there were in fact the agreement, the 1600 agreement was in fact issued for that project. And although I don't share my fishery colleagues' concern about fish passage because I find too many fish of all sorts upstream of beaver dams, I did share a lot of their concerns about where the site was located, how it was being constructed, a lot of the decisions that were being made as part of that. And I, for certain, was one of the people who weighed in very heavily on the monitoring component, right? Tell me what's going on there. Tell me what's going on there biologically. Tell me also what's going on there physically. And I've not seen any of that monitoring information. In fact, I think that most of it was not, if any of it, was not collected in the time period before the baseline, before the project was built, or post-project construction. I'm happy if what you're saying is that there's been monitoring since that time, because I've been checked out of this for about a year. If there's monitoring going on since then, I think that's great. But in terms of someone like myself supporting that project as an experiment, yeah. which I did and was a voice of support for, that project has not been implemented as an experiment, and it's not been monitored as an experiment, which provides no foundation for me going forward or looking positively on future projects that are going to be experimental, where I don't see the community, the people on the ground, the local experts delivering on the one thing that I've asked that would allow me to support future experiments. That's the one comment. The other is I've worked for almost two decades in the 1600 program, and I have to say that across the board, the biggest hurdle for us accomplishing what that regulation set out to do, which was to protect stream resources of all sorts, even those without a charismatic fish in it, my biggest hurdle has been the community of people that I've had to work with, that we push back way further in terms of protection if we could than the community will allow us. So I appreciate what you're saying about the dialogue necessary between the community and the regulatory community and our responsibility to think creatively, but I'm struck with the fact that almost two decades of my experience shows me that my conversation tends to be very, very one-directional. So I find it a little bit distressing to say that we need to think more creatively about regulation. I think I agree. Watershed group, yes. Dialogue, yes. But I was willing to go way down the road in those particular projects and think very creatively about their implementation. But my needs on the back end have not been met.
Well, I can, those really, really good points. And I think from my perspective, my needs have not been met either. And my needs are very similar to your needs. And there's a number of reasons why the data that we would like to have collected was not collected in the manner. And a lot of it has to do with the regulatory framework not being set up for an experiment. So a lot of effort. So, for example, the pit tagging was to be a collaborative effort with CDFW, so to monitor the fish. Well, the person that was going to do that left, right? So left CDFW. So that was a curveball. Then the people that could carry on didn't have the proper incidental take permit, so there's been an effort to get that. So, and that's just one example. Another example is that there was some interest after setting up the design, you know, a scientific experiment, say, here's what we're going to do, here's how we're going to do it, and moving forward, then some of the regulatory community weighed in with how they wanted it done. So it got into a case of, you know, sort of a classic too many cooks spoiling the soup, and so we weren't able to test some of the things that we wanted to test. And there was a lot of dialogue that had to go on because this was a kind of a new idea with some of the people. There were other relocations of people quitting within the CDFW and actually elsewhere and other state agencies. So there was people coming in with ideas, we hadn't had that educational opportunity with them. So they came in with ideas about what was right or wrong, and really, I think, in several instances, a more of the by-the-book approach. So we spent a lot of time talking to people, explaining and having a dialogue and having people weigh in with wanting changes to the basic experimental design. And so it's really just a pain in the butt to do any kind of experiment on this large a scale. And so it's really hard, and it's been very frustrating. And so that we've been able to get some data has felt like a major accomplishment. And I, you know, I would really like to be able to get more. And it's a struggle. And I don't know that we're going to be able to because of just this ongoing kind of regulatory complexity getting out of my field. I mean, I will tell you.
Well, just, you know, as an aside in terms of partnering with CDFW, I can't have been the only person who questioned our ability to deliver on the monitoring for this project.
Yeah, I
was I? Okay, so what I would say is before the project was implemented, I questioned staff availability, time, and money.
Okay,
and
good for you.
Only in the part that didn't get listened to. So I guess my comment would be that it's great after the fact to be thinking about how people can educate me or other people in the department, but I think the dialogue needed to be well in advance of that with a very realistic discussion on just how difficult the monitoring that you're proposing to do is. And I don't, to my knowledge, if it occurred, it was occurring in a round robin fashion rather than in a collective discussion where we were all going to the finish line together with a very realistic idea of what we might accomplish and what we might not accomplish. And similarly, on the structures that they were subsequently built on the main stem, Scott, I can say with some certainty that there were adjacent landowners who had a less than perfect idea or understanding of what the potential result of those structures were relative to the movement of water onto their property. Where was that dialogue where people understand what the risk not just to the fish is or the aquatic species, but the dialogue with the landowner who understands that these things are intended to spread water out under the floodplain? It happened, but it was a surprise to a collaborative partner of ours. So
when you're talking about, kind of was joking to somebody, I said, we went into experiment with the effects of a structure on the ecological responses, but really it turned into an experiment of how do you run an experiment in a watershed context. And I think in general, the communication, we've never talked. I never heard about any of your concerns. We never did have a gathering of people that were interested in the project and talking about deliverables and outside of the immediate, grant. Those funders that had to be addressed, and it was in that context. But I think that it was like classic management or collaborative management. Roles and responsibilities was not hammered out. There was, as far as outreach though, there was tremendous. This was one of the things that was and still is exciting about this project is that it came from the community. So it originated from the community, that they wanted to pursue this and move forward. So there was a lot of internal community outreach, and then there was extensive discussions with particular landowners, and in this case, the Scott River Watershed Council and the landowner in question repeatedly talked to them after every single flood event and communicated. So there was an awful lot of communication, yet still apparently not enough. So, having, I think, the big powwow or what, I don't know. I'm a scientist, right? And I do policy analysis. Sort of how you work in this large-scale collaborative process to facilitate these kinds of restoration projects, that's the question at hand. And I think that we can look at this ongoing process and say, well, what are we learning? And not just what are we learning about the fish or the riparian vegetation or the groundwater recharge, but what are we learning about the collaborative structure or network, the communication protocols, all of that. There's so much to learn from this. And I think, we went for it. We made it. If we didn't try to move forward and do it, even with all that uncertainty, we wouldn't be having this discussion right now. And so I think it's been very good to facilitate this. And, I'm still left with this, how come you and I never talked about this? To get right down to it, I don't know, but it sounds like that there's definitely communication protocols that need developing.
Just
figured you were busy.
That's probably an offline conversation.
I guess I should ask you, did I answer your question?
I could go on that stuff as well, but I'm not gonna. I'm just what I wanted to get at was basically measures of success. You mentioned something about some of the different projects having levels of measures of success, but the definitions of those seem to be mostly, certainly in restoration, very vague, which means that you don't set up an actual question that you're trying to answer, or and it sounds like in this case that's exactly what happened. But my concern was more along the lines when you mentioned the setting up an IP for beaver.
Oh, yeah.
What I'm curious about is, given the discontinuity in the landscape here with houses and open space and some more houses, and the fact that these animals are just that, they're animals, and where we put them is most likely they're not going to stay, or they might. We don't know. But they have a propensity for moving, and if they are successful in kitting out and what, then those will be moving somewhere. And so how do you suggest we mitigate for the liability of moving something into an area where it may not have ever existed, depending on the paleontological record or not, but how do we mitigate for something where we put this live animal that could cause flooding, property damage, those sorts of things?
That's a good question. And your name is, I'm sorry?
My name is Joe Pichotto.
I think that that's a really good question. As far as movement of beaver, to me, that's really sort of a down-the-road thing. It seems like it's a high-hanging fruit. My experience is that there's a lot of beaver in the landscape, or there's enough, and that if there's good habitat, they'll find it. There's a lot of controls out there. I mean, the Scott Valley, for example, since we were talking about that, there's a lot of beaver in that system. They're not taking over. They're not exploding in population. They're around, and so as some of these habitats, so what's kind of exciting about some of these structures is that the beaver are colonizing them, and they're using them. My sense is that if there's good habitat, they will get there eventually. So I don't think at this time, really, unless there's been some extirpation, that we need to be thinking about moving them too much. I think that in some cases it might be appropriate, and there's been a couple of things. So that's been done elsewhere, and what's generally been found is that there's a great study in Oregon, for example, looking at landowner tolerances. What they found is that generally landowners are much more tolerant than people perceive, especially when you get into a ranching community and with beaver. If they're in Utah, they say, yeah, we can manage beaver fine. If they're a problem, we'll shoot them. And so it's not really... here in California, we're kind of anxious, wow, look at all the animal cruelty and all this, and we can't do that, PETA. And so I think that there are some sort of straightforward solutions to any perceived problem, and there's some straightforward sort of management approaches. But I don't think any of the issues that you raised are really insurmountable. And mostly what I see with people that have beaver on their properties, or if they get to another location, is that there's more than enough people out there willing to move them or to put in flow control devices or covert caging. There's enough, again, with the sort of communication with people on the ground, there's a lot of opportunity to address and mitigate the problems as they arise. But you gotta look at the lead-based deterrent as an ultimate solution. And I think, I guess you guys ban lead now here, so that's bad. Okay, but lethal removal. More, needs to always be on the table, and it's not very hard. We know how to take out beaver. We almost ran into extinction, so I'm pretty confident that if the beaver get to be a problem, we're going to be able to get that population down. I haven't seen it anywhere yet that's ever occurred where they became such a nuisance in the western states.
Yeah, well, I think the concern is more along the lines of restoration or restorationists. Grabbing potential ideas like this IP thing for beaver and saying, aha, that's our solution. They have it. There is that tendency, certainly in this state, for that to happen. And there's certainly the strong tendency of wanting to move beaver everywhere right now because that's thought of this great restoration tool when we're not even sure what we're restoring to, like Terry was talking about.
Yeah, well, again, that I think in my mind, I'm a scientist, so I look at it like, okay, let's do some controlled experiments then. Let's see what happens. Monitor it and address it. I mean, they had the same issue in Scotland where the beaver had been extirpated for, almost a millennia, I think. And there was a lot of people that are raising up very similar issues, and there's a lot of opposition. And finally, they got beaver in, and they started monitoring them, and the population expanded and stuff, and they started developing ways of managing them, and they just began to incorporate them in, and people became more accepting of it once they saw what they did and, what more importantly, what they didn't do. And so it's sort of an iterative process, and there's, in general, at least in Washington and Oregon, there's growing acceptance and willingness to work with them and interest and there's a group of, if you've got a group of people willing in a watershed or an area willing to work with and manage, you can generally, again, with communication, manage them. And so I think it's great. People are excited, and I think there's some great places that there's clear evidence of historical beaver activity. Go to those places, put them in, let them do their thing, and see what happens, and monitor. I mean, address the risk through monitoring. That's sort of the...
Okay, well, it's about 3 o'clock, so we'll wrap up. Thank you so much for coming, and thank you guys for being here.
Thank you for your questions. I really appreciate that. I mean, I wanted to get as much out of this as you did. I hope you got something out of it. I did want to make this slide available, or the slideshow available. I don't know if that is how you do that or if you can post it.
Yes, so we will post your presentation as a PDF on our website.
Okay. So I will just leave you with this then on the way out. Is I had some regulatory issues at the end, and I had some scenarios, and they're up here, and there's another set here, and it was in the context of beaver dams or BDAs. So look at those. They're sort of rhetorical, but not rhetorical, but so how, because we're talking about making an informed decision about how to manage them, and they're not cookbook issues. And so thinking about it, you don't need to answer them right now, but thinking about that, so we can, again, move the ball forward, because every decision has a trade-off. In this case, it's a trade-off of habitat for juveniles or adults. Anyway, read those and get back to me if you have any great, brilliant solutions. Thanks again.